this case, I think that Tom don't need a great presentation. Everybody, I imagine, already know him and his activity. He made a lot of experience in several fields, and so he worked in the force, U.S. force. He worked for. He's working. Oh, perfectly! Just in time, we are live streaming. So, and the last he reported in the CV published on the website that his third activity is working on sailing application, and so he's a specialist in control and design system and relationship between rigging and sail. So he worked for Oracle, and so I imagine that he has a lot of experience, a lot of information that can spread, can share with us. So Tom, please, if you can take place here. I start your presentation. Do you want me to help you, or you do by yourself? Okay.
Okay, I want to start by expressing my appreciation to the sponsors, SLAM and Pereira and PAC Pindar, PWT and CSAIL for supporting this event and making it possible. And of course, all the people who brought these incredible boats here, just fantastic to be able to see the things that you only read about in magazines and on the internet. And a special thanks to Luca and Domenico and Andreas for taking care of me while I've been here. And I'm especially grateful for the opportunity to meet all of my longtime friends who I've now and meet it for the first time. So I also have an apology for you because I know that I have more graphs and detail than you can absorb in time available in my talk. So everything is on the web at this address, and so you can look at it afterwards in more detail. So this is going to be kind of like a time-lapse movie where what's important is to sit back and pay attention to the flow and not try to absorb all the details as we're going on. Okay, next slide. Okay, so I'm basically a blind man looking at an elephant. And like the proverbial blind man, I know that some of what I'm telling you today is true and some will not be true. But just because of my limited view so far of the subject. So I've been very fascinated by how the A-class design rule makes it, you know, impacts the ability to fly these boats. And of course, this is very early days yet for the A-class. So the questions I want to consider in this talk are you know, how does the design rule impact the fly? What kind of board characteristics affect that you can do within the design rule? And kind of what is the trade-off between drag and stability for the A-class? And then finally, a little bit of speculation about where the class might go in the future. Now, in all of this, I'm really trying to focus on understanding the characteristics and not so much trying to come up with a design for the best foil for the A-class. So, in many ways, my talk follows directly on to Martin Fisher's talk. He had all the principles, and now I'm going to be applying those same principles to a specific example. So some of the terms that I'm going to use in the talk, I want to talk about angle of attack, which is going to be, when I talk about angle of attack, it will be the angle of the vertical plane between the boat and the velocity vector, and leeway will be the angle between the velocity vector and the boat and the horizontal plane. Of course, heel is the rollback of the boat. Every sailor knows about that. Rake, I'm going to mean as being the tilting of the dagger foil relative to the hull, and positive when this leading edge up to reduces more lift. And then finally, the flying height will be the height of the hull above the water as the boat flies higher. And I'm only going to consider the boat flying. I'm not going to have anything about the boat in the water or how do you get to the point where it's flying. So let's talk about the requirements for the A-class. You know, how much
does this boat have to support on the foils?
So this is very similar to Martin's chart. The principal forces that are applied to the boat are the aerodynamic side force from the sail, and that's under control of the sailor. And of course, the weight of the boat and the sailor that provide the stability, it also has to be supported by the foils. And then the foils produce a vertical lift and a horizontal component, and then these add together to create the riding moment from the foils. And I've taken the riding moment here as being about the center line of the boat and positive when it's tending to hold the boat upright. Now, the foils produce their lift by deflecting the flow sideways. And so you get this trailing wash in the wake that eventually rolls up into these trailing vortices. And the lifting line analysis that Mario talked about yesterday is basically taking a cross section through this wake, and you look at the projection of the foils and how the wash is distributed along the length of the foils. And I'll be talking about that quite a bit, because that determines what this drag due to lift is. And I'm only going to include the lift-induced drag. I'm not going to talk about the drag due to the boundary layer effects, like skin friction or pressure drag due to separation. So I'm only going to cover the drag due to lift, because I think I don't want to confound it with other drag sources, and I think that makes it a little bit more understandable. So the horizontal force has to equal the side force in the sail rig, and the vertical force has to equal the weight of the boat and the crew. And then this hydrodynamic riding moment has to equal the moment that's available from the crew. So the sailor will adjust the side force until this moment balance comes into balance. So then the leeway and the angle of attack will adjust themselves in order to make this balance happen out of the steady state. So the leeway and angle of attack really are the result of this, and rather than being an independent parameter that's set arbitrarily. So in the calculations that I've done, what I've assumed is that the vertical force is going to equal the total weight, and that this moment will equal the riding moment available from the sailor, and then I've allowed the side force to vary until that balance is achieved. So for the boat to fly stably, there are at least three necessary conditions. And so think of the boat as flying stably in equilibrium, so everything is trimmed out, and then experiencing some disturbance of that equilibrium. For heave stability, other than vertical motion, what you have to have happen is as the boat rises up, the lift of the foils has to decrease. So this will then tend to bring it back down to that equilibrium position. The next condition is it must be stable in pitch, which means that if it pitches bow up, but at the same flying height, then there must be a pitching moment that will bring the bow back down. So the change in pitching moment with a change in attitude has to be less than zero. And then there's a parameter that deals with the coupling between these two things. And for that, when there's an increase in flying height, you want the boat to want to pitch bow down. And if the boat wants to pitch bow up, then it will be unstable, because what will happen is as it pitches up due to an increase in flying height, that will increase the lift make it increase more, make it pitch up more, and you get the boat zooming out of the water and then crashing back down.
So the way that we design the boats to achieve this
is for heave stability, there are really three ways to do it. One is with surface piercing foils that reduce the amount of area, because lift at a given angle of attack is proportional to area. If you reduce the area, you come up, you'll reduce the lift and bring the boat back down. And the V-foils and ladder foils work this way. There's active feedback, which you're all familiar with from the moth, where we artificially reduce the lift by deflecting the flap up as the boat comes up, as measured by the wand. And then there's kind of a new way that was discovered by Team New Zealand during the last America's Cup campaign, and that is to use leeway as a means of regulating this. And the way this works is the boat has to produce a constant side force to oppose the side force from the rig. So as the boat comes up, there's a reduction in the vertical area of the foil, which is kind of similar to the surface piercing foil. But now what happens is the leeway increases so that the boat maintains the same side force with less area. And if you arrange the lifting foil with dihedral, then that leeway basically changes the angle of attack of the foil. You can think of it sort of impacting on the top of the foil, and that reduces the vertical lift and brings the boat back down. So leeway is acting like a middleman. The boat goes up, the leeway increases, the leeway reduces the lift, the boat comes back down. Now, to achieve stability in pitch, what you need is you need to have the forward foil to be more heavily loaded per square meter than the aft foil. And if you do that, then when the boat changes its angle of attack, there will be more lift generated on the aft foil, and it'll bring the bow back down. Now, to get the stable coupling between the pitch and heave motions, what you need is you need the forward foil to be basically more sensitive to height than the aft foil. And this is why a surface piercing foil or an actively controlled foil as your main foil with a fully submerged stern foil works so well, because the T-foil has very little sensitivity to height. And so all of the heave control is being done with the forward foil. And that way, when you come up and the lift decreases on the forward foil, it makes the boat pitch over because the lift on the stern is essentially unchanged. But it also applies when the hull is in the water. And the large sections of the stern are comparatively stiff in heave. You only have to immerse the stern a few more centimeters and you get a lot of buoyancy off of the stern. So what happens is when a boat starts to take off dragging the stern, it wants to pivot about the stern. So now as it comes up, it gets an increase in angle, which is unstable and makes it want to come up here. So if you can arrange it so that you move your weight forward or trim the stern foil so the boat lifts off level or even lifts the stern out of the water first, then it comes up stably and you don't have this big transient as it leaps off the water, which is kind of an unnatural to think about the stern coming off the water first, but in fact, with stability, that's the best thing to do. Now, in this talk, I'm not really going to get into these other stability aspects. I'm only going to talk about the stability of the daggerboard itself.
Okay, so
for the A class, these were the requirements that I assumed. I assumed that the total weight of the boat was 160 kilograms. That allows 75 kilograms for the boat, which is the class minimum weight, and 85 kilograms for the crew. So it's a little on the heavy side for the crew. I also assumed that the center gravity of the crew was about a meter outboard of the boat, which gives a total weight angle of about 180 kilograms. Kilogram meters, excuse me. And And then we have the limits of the in the A-class rule itself on the design, which is the maximum beam of 2.3 meters, and then the foil can only extend in to 750 millimeters from the center line. And so that severely constrains the span of the foil that you can work with. And I also assume that the deckboard trunk is approximately on the center line of the hull, which puts it at about 1 meter from the center line of the boat. And I've also assumed the boards are rigid, so I'm not allowing the boards to bend in and exceed that span. And for most of the talk, I'm also assuming that the boards are set symmetrically between the port and starboard side. So I'm not looking until the very end of the talk on breaking boards differentially. So nearly everything, the boards will be set the same, because in the single-handed class, the sailor really doesn't have time to be messing with the boards. He can't actively control them, and even and he doesn't have time to pull them up and put one down. So the A-class sails with both boards in the water all the time, and that makes it different from the AC-72s that we use in the America's Cup campaign. So these are kind of the geometric parameters I looked at in the design. I assume that the board came out of the hull on the center line, and then I wanted to have the maximum span, so I assume the board came out to the max beam limit, and then had a rounded radius, and then another straight section that terminated at the inner beam limit. So the geometric parameters I've varied are basically, how big is this radius, and what is this dihedral angle down here? And then I arranged the rest of the geometry so it just fit within that box. And then, of course, this whole thing tilts as the boat heels. So then there's a greater or lesser amount of the board that's in the water on each side due to the heel of the boat, and also due to the flying height, which as the boat flies higher, of course, then there's less foil in the water.
So let's go on and talk about these, talk about foil.
So these are the shapes that I've considered so far. I looked at a C foil, which has a very large radius, and the dihedral angle at the bottom was 30 degrees down. I looked at a J foil, which has a tighter radius and a dihedral of minus 15. Then I bent it some more to make an L foil, so that the bottom was horizontal. And then to kind of look at the effect of both dihedral and radius, I looked at what I call a chevron foil, which has 45 degrees down on the dihedral. Now, so far I've only looked at a constant chord, so they have just a rectangular plan form, and I also arranged it so that all of these had the same arc length. So there's the same area in all of these foils. And so the only difference is dihedral angle and the radius of curvature. And then where this radius was vertically, I arranged so that I got that same length. So those are the shapes that I've looked at so far. Now, you know, we mentioned that lifting line analysis. So if you think about that plane in the wake, the heavy line here represents the board itself. So you imagine your fish following along, and you're looking at this board in the water. This is what you would see. The thin line, this is the load distribution along the span of that board. And then the dotted line, this is the wake wash, the velocity as the wake is being deflected to the side. Now, for minimum drag due to lift, you would want this wash to be uniform along the span of the foil. So the fact that there's an increase in the tip means that this planform is not optimal from this respect to drag. If you were to taper it a little bit, you'd get less lift here, less wash, and less drag. So these rectangular planforms can definitely be improved upon. But you can see the difference in the loading. If this is the C foil, And you can see how much load is carried down here on the bottom of the, this is the leeward foil. So we're on, as you're looking at it, we're on starboard tack, and that's the port foil. And there's also a considerable amount of lift being carried by the windward board in order to support the bow. And we're getting side force, the windward foil side force is nearly canceling. We've got some this way and some on the shoulder of the foil this way. And then all of this is contributing to the side force on the leeward foil. Now, as the foil comes up, here it is 400 millimeters higher in the water. And you can see that the load has increased significantly on the leeward foil. And it's about the same on the bottom, but we're missing this lift contribution from the shoulder of the foil and the windward foil. So the load is shifting to the leeward foil as the boat comes up. And here are what those characteristics are like. This chart shows the angle of attack in blue and the leeway in red for the entire boat. And you can see that the angle of attack doesn't change very much. There's an increase in angle of attack as the shoulders of the sea foil come out of the water. But then when it's basically the vertical part of the foil, there's not much change in angle of attack because there's no, you're not losing any of the horizontal areas that comes up. And then, but the leeway is increasing this whole time because there's less and less vertical area of the board in the water. And as a result, here is the lift. So here is the lift on the leeward board. Here is the lift on the windward board. So you can see as you're coming up, the total I've kept constant. That's the green line. And these whiskers that you see, that's due to some variations that I've made. So at each point, what I've done is, this is the point where the boat's completely in trim. The side force equals the side force of the sail, and the vertical force equals the weight of the boat. And then I kept that same angle of attack, and I varied the height. And I let the vertical lift change, but I kept the heeling moment the same. So I allowed the leeway to change in order to maintain that same heeling moment from the sailor. And then, like I say, the vertical force changed. So here you can see the sensitivity of the vertical force due to that change in height at a constant angle of attack. So the slope of these whiskers is the heave stability of the boat. And this is the righting moment. You can see that the heeling moment from the windward foil is about constant as the boat comes up. But the increased lift on the leeward foil means that the righting moment goes from being negative, where there's actually so much lift on the windward foil that the boat is trying to heel more to leeward, to being strongly positive when the boat is well out of the water. And as a result, the side force changes, because with more heeling moment, the sailor can trim on harder with the sail. So here's the leeward foil decreasing it, the side force on it, and then increasing. And then this is the total, and this is the side force from the windward foil. So initially, what happens is the foils actually start to oppose each other more, and then as you come up even further, now because the windward foil is almost coming out of the water, they're not fighting each other as much, and then finally the total is all being done by the leeward foil. So here's kind of, all right, so here's the bottom line. This is the heave stiffness, which is the slope of those whiskers that I talked about. And this is for the entire boat. And it's showing that with the boat upright, a negative number is stable. So you want to be in this direction. So it starts off very stable. The stability decreases. And then the stability of the sea foil increases. Now, the dotted lines show what happens with at 10 degrees of heel to leeward. So with heel, the stability decreases a lot. And it gets a little bit better, and kind of out here in the normal flying height, it's about the same for the seafoil. And then this shows the rate of change of the leeway angle and how it starts off fairly constant, and then it shoots up as the boat comes out of the water, and there's less and less vertical area of the foil to oppose the leeway. And then here's the drag. So this is we start off with the drag due to lift being about the same, a little bit more on the leeward foil than the windward foil. And as the load shifts to the leeward foil, the drag due to lift increases for the leeward foil because it's being more heavily loaded and it has less span, and while the drag is dropping off. But the drag due to lift is increasing steadily. And it's not so bad. You get to about 300 to 400 millimeters. But after that, it really shoots up, and the drag increases quite rapidly due to the fact that you're reducing the span of the foil that's in the water. So that's kind of a thumbnail of what the seafoil is like, and the other foils behave somewhat similarly. So from here on, I'm just going to talk about the totals for the boat, and not go into detail between the windward and the leeward foils. So I want to remind you again of the shapes that I use. Consider, because I want you to pay attention to the colors, because the color coding that I'm going to show you on the next graphs corresponds to these shapes: blue for the C, red for the J, green for the L. So here's the drag for these foils, and again, solid lines are upright, and dashed lines are 10 degrees of heel. And what was really surprising is how similar the drag is for such a wide range of flashes. Now, they're similar in that they have the same area and they have the same horizontal span. But different dihedral angles, different curvatures. I was kind of amazed that they were so similar in drag. And here they are in stability. Now, initially, at takeoff, the seafoil had more stability. But if you look at sort of in the normal flying height range at around, say, 300 millimeters, there's a clear order here. The L foil in green has no dihedral. And then you have 50 degrees for the J foil, 30 degrees for the seafoil, 45 degrees for the chevron foil. So at the sort of normal flying height, the more dihedral down, the more stable the board is in the vertical direction. And that's kind of the opposite of what you get with a single L-foil, where you need to have a positive dihedral, and the more positive dihedral you get, the more stable it is. So this is a very surprising thing to me to find out that you actually want to put the foils down for more stability on the A-class, because you have two foils in the water instead of one. Yeah, and so here's the riding moment from the foils. So now there's a bit more of a difference. Generally, the riding moment is improving as the foil as the load shifts to the leeward foil. And now the chevron foil and the sea foil have less, and they are better, because now you want a positive riding moment. This point represents what you would get with just the leeward hull in the water and no boards. And then if you think of a straight board, that actually adds some heeling moment. So you're probably going to be somewhere in the range shown by this red line. So you can kind of think of this as a reference for what a normal A-class would be that isn't foiling. And so we have much less riding moment from the boards flying than we do with the boat floating, until we get pretty high up. And then it starts to become comparable. But initially, there's a lot less riding moment due to that lift on the windward foil. And here's the side force, which is a direct consequence of that heeling moment. The more the boat wants to heel, the less the sailor can trim in on the sail. So If the normal boat would be up around 80 kilograms or more, were quite a bit less. And so there's a lot less sail power that's available to the boat that's flying. And then that improves as we come up. And here, the chevron and the seafoil are the best. They provide the most sail power. And the alfoil is the worst. So it's looking like the seafoil is a pretty good choice. And it provides good stability, and it provides good sail power for the A-class. Okay, so I want to remind you again, this is what the loading looks like on the seafoil as it's at. The boards are set parallel to the boat, and it's fully submerged. The hull is just out of the water. And so now I'm just going to talk about the seafoil, because the other foils acted somewhat similar, and the seafoil looks like a good choice. So now I'm going to start doing some tuning variations with the seafoil. So the first thing I want to do is to tow in and tow out the entire foil. Okay? So here the board is towed in 3 degrees. And you can see that it's reduced the loading up on the shoulders of the seafoil, increased the loading down below. And this is with the board towed out 3 degrees. So now we have a much bigger loading up on the shoulders and smaller loading on the bottom of the foil. Okay, so here's what the effects of that looks like. So pretty similar in drag for all the cases, except big increase in drag for tow out. And the effect on riding moment is, with the boat upright, there's almost no change between those three. And but when it's heeled up, then there's a clear change where tow out has more riding moment. And in terms of heave stability, a big difference between those three cases. Tow out has much more stability than tow in. Tow in is actually unstable. And as a result, this is somewhat similar to that there's almost no change in sail power upright, but when you heel it, tow out provided more sail power. Now, what would be the effect of twisting the foil? So there's really kind of four cases. You can hold the top fixed and twist the bottom, or you can hold the bottom fixed and twist the top. So here's the case where I'm holding the bottom fixed and I'm twisting the top. And so twisting at 5 degrees is like towing it in, but not at the bottom, of course. And then twisting -5 is kind of like towing out. And then here's the case of holding the top fixed and twisting the bottom versus in each direction. So here I've got what we call wash in, which is an increase in angle attack at the bottom. And here is wash out, which is a decrease in angle attack. So there's, surprisingly, even though I'm holding the top fixed, there's a change in the lift at the top, because the entire side force and lift still have to match the weight and the side force of the sail rig. And here's the effect. As you might expect, the towing out at the top looks just like the tow out case, a big increase of drag. The other surprising thing was, at the bottom, holding top fixed and washing out at the bottom reduced the induced drag. So, and pretty substantially across the entire flying range. And that's because of the rectangular platform that has too much lift at the tip. The rest of this is pretty much the same story that you might expect in terms of the impact of stability. Washing out looks pretty good compared to the basic foil. There's an increase in stability and a decrease in drag. So that looks like it'd be a pretty good tuning move for these foils. And if we look at the total trade-off, this is a very busy chart. It's got everything on it. And the main thing I want to show is this is the drag. And then this is the stability. And you want to be in this corner. You want to be very stable with no drag. And you can see that the general trend on everything is an increase in drag for an increase in stability. So there's no free lunch here. What you do to try to make it stable will almost invariably increase the drag. So that you have this tension between the making it easy to fly and having good performance. And I guess that's what makes boat design an art.
All right, so
just kind of set off, this is kind of what I've explored in this elephant of A-class design. I've looked at CJ and L shapes. The flying, you have less sail power available to you because of the lift of the wooden foil. And pointing the foils down improves stability, but adds some drag. Healing the lure is generally destabilizing, but it does improve the sail power of the riding moment. And for sea boards, toe in is destabilizing, toe out is stabilizing, but comes with a big drag penalty. And washing out the seaboards for a rectangular platform reduces the drag and increases the stability.
So, where to go from here? So let's talk about maybe what you would do
in the future. The problem is, of course, this symmetry that I assume, which this is the loading just due to angle of attack, and you see how it's the same on both foils.
And so what we'd like to do is
to basically break that symmetry. So I looked at one more foil, which is kind of like the L. It has the same radius as the L, but it has the same dihedral as the J foil. So you can think of this as being a curvature variation on here and as a dihedral variation on this. But I went with this because it has a long straight portion. And then I looked at raking this in asymmetrically. So here are the results where I've this is with no rake, and then this is with no rake, and then these two curves, what I've done is I've raked 5 degrees one way and 5 degrees the other way. And as you would expect, you can get a big increase in riding moment by increasing the lift on the leeward foil and decreasing lift on the windward foil. And there's very little change in stability from doing it. You basically just, it's quite similar to the sea foil when you're raked like that. And a big increase in the sail power. So differential rake looks like it would be really important to improving the performance of A-class foils. And there have to be some simple ways to do that. You know, probably just a setting for port tack, starboard tack, and neutral that the sailor can just toggle as he goes across the boat onto the new tack.
And
another way that I thought about doing this and haven't looked into very much is to have a floating flap. So if you put a flap on the foil like the Moth, but be manually controlled instead of having a wand, you could put the flap down on the leeward side and just let it float freely on the windward side. And what that will do is these solid curves are the lift versus angle of attack for a typical section, and the dashed curves are the hinge moment of the flap. So the flap will trim where the hinge moment is zero. So at this flap angle, that corresponds to 12 degrees. At zero angle of attack, of course, the flap wants to trim straight neutral at zero lift, and then the other way here. So if you take these points and you come down and you say that lift and this lift and up here, then you effectively get this black line. So it's like you reduce the lift curve slope of the foil by allowing the flap to float. And so you effectively made the windward foil smaller. And so that would be an easy way to be able to get the asymmetry that you need to improve the riding moment. So that's basically all I've got so far. Lots more to explore on these A-class foils, and I'll take any questions if you have.
collect all the questions sure. for the end of the morning, like we do yesterday. Thank you very much for the contribution. I found it very, very interesting, very detailed comparison in different items which we can work in design to realize a voice system. I think that connected to this consideration, there are also some items connected to the construction, so the reaction of the foil according to the load. Probably tomorrow with Kensington we will have the opportunity to discuss of that, so we have time to go deeper in this topic. Then I suggest keep on flying, and so I ask a pilot to take place at the desk, Thomas Zohr, who developed a system called Bufoil, and which he showed us his boat flying on the water, and now he can go deeper in discussing.
Here is the for this.
Okay.
Do you have audio?
Sorry?
Do you have something with audio?
No, just make a screen. That's it. I will just
try if it's working.
Yeah,
let's go.
Okay. Okay. Please.
Hello, my name is Thomas Zohr, and today I'm here to present my work in the field of hydrofoils. I'm the founder and the leader of the WFOIL project, which has been running for the last 13 years. I have developed some kind of new hydrofoil concept and named it the WFOIL concept. So my starting point was my aeronautical and aerodynamic knowledge and a lot of experience as a pilot. I have more than 12,000 hours on different types of aircraft. As I have seen, I'm the only one at this event presenting a hydrofoil powerboat concept. At this point, I have to say that the WFOIL concept is a hydrofoil concept, which is suitable for powerboats and for sailing boats as well. We started with powerboats because powerboats represent approximately 80% of the leisure boat market, and of course, we would like to live off our work. But my soul and passion go to sailing, definitely. And maybe someday I will get a chance to apply the WFOIL concept to top sailing boats as well. So my brief presentation today will explain the basic characteristic of the WFOIL concept, its advantages, and its potential of applying to different vessels. Let's start with the basics. You see? As we all know, we have constant wetted systems with a height regulation, and we have hydrofoil concept, which is a combination of constant wetted systems and surface piercing systems. But with our WFOIL concept, we are thinking a little bit differently. So the WFOIL concept is a surface piercing 2V canard hydrofoil concept with a swept hydrofoil design, which enables cavitation control. That's the definition in general. So the essence of transonic aeronautics is to control local velocities and pressures on the wing. I'm using the same tricks and solutions as passenger and military jets. Behavior of the water at a speed of 40 knots or more, that of course depends on the hydrofoil cross-section on hydrofoils, is very similar to behavior of the air at the wing at around Mach 1. First, I would like to explain a few basic things in a very popular and simple way. Let's look at the similarities between the water and the air. We have the same number of balls passing over the certain surface per time unit in the water and in the air. The difference is that on one side we have high density in the water and on the other we have high speed in the air. Imagine that balls passing over the hydrofoil are connected with the elastic links. With the pressure dropping, those links become more and more strained. The balls, if we look three-dimensional, the balls spatially spread out. And at certain point, that links just break. We call that point cavitation appearance or boiling of the water. The local speed on the upper surface of the hydrofoil is the controlling element to not reach the point where cavitation appears, or according to my popular explanation, where the elastic links between the balls break. That was some basics. Now I would like to present advantages of the W-foil concept and compare its characteristic with the classical T or L settings of hydrofoils. With the W-foil concept, the wetted surfaces of all hydrodynamic elements are reduced with the speed increment. So the main hydrodynamic drag stays at the same value throughout the whole speed range. Here I would like to point out that here I'm talking just about the main hydrodynamic, the profile drag. Here we can see that the constant weight, here we have example for just one foil. Constant weight needs a constant lift. So the product of this formula has to be the same. This is the formula for the lift, as you know, and the same story is with the formula for the drag. So with speed increment, square of the speed, the wetted surfaces have to be reduced. The W-foil concept produces approximately 30% more drag than the constant wetted concept at the moment when vessel become foil-borne. But its water drag stay, I'm talking just about the main water drag, stay at the same value throughout the whole speed range, while the constant wetted concept gain we saw from the formula, its water drag with the square of the speed. As a benefit of the W-foil concept, there is a possibility of changing the beta angle. So, at low speed, we can operate very close to TL concept, this position of the hydrofoil, and with speed increasing, we can increase beta angle and gain all the benefits of the W-foil concept. The 2V surface piercing hydrofoil setting is a perfect platform to explore the swept hydrofoil design to its maximum and to control cavitation appearance up to speeds greater than maximum speeds reached by hydrofoil so far. There is a great difference of the progressive speed of the vessel and the local speed of water on the surface of swept hydrofoil. The local speed is responsible for lift, drag and cavitation appearance. And just short definition, the local speed is always a component, as we see from this diagram, of the progressive speed of the vessel perpendicular to the tangent on the leading edge of the hydrofoil. Because of applying the swept angle to hydrofoils, we can reach much higher maximum speeds with the W-foil concept than with other hydrofoil concepts. For example, maximum, now I'm talking about the design speed of our Albatross is around 60 knots, and the concept theoretically can go up to 80 knots, maybe more, in general. Additionally, of course, we can control cavitation appearance with the hydrofoil cross-section optimization. With our hydrofoil design, we have reduced induced drag as well. At the tip of the hydrofoil, the swept angle is 90 degrees, and consequently, the lift of the hydrofoil there is very close to zero. Because of the curved swept leading edge of the hydrofoil, we can control the appearance of cavitation. At the tip lower area, the hydrofoil is designed with a great swept angle and it's suitable for high speeds, while at the upper root area, the hydrofoil is designed with a small or zero swept angle and it's suitable for low speeds. So, when at high speeds, the waves flow over tip area and reach upper root area, which is not designed for high speeds, cavitation appears and reduces extra drag and lift. That makes the flight much smoother than it would be without such a hydrofoil design. Here we have another advantage of the W-foil concept. The W-foil is an art of the dim concept. Because of that, we can load greater load, or we can reduce hydrofoil load for greater speeds. We can lift hull out of the water at lower speeds. With the W-foil concept allow us to design hydrofoils with the big root section areas. And that allow us to lift hull out of the water at really low speeds. Yesterday on the water, you could see that when I pulled the throttle, the boats went out and it's immediately. Theoretically, the minimum foilborne speed for our Albatross is approximately 5 knots. That depends on the weight, one or two passenger, and so on. Now let me explain briefly the stability of the W-foil concept. Here I would like to point out that I'm coming from aviation field and I'm using the aviation phraseology. I would like to excuse because of that, but that's bank stability you call it hill or something. Yeah, I learned it now. Let's start with the bank stability. The two times with the headwell allow us to reach great stability around the longitudinal axis, and that's this. I have to point out that we are achieving that just by settings and shape of hydrofoils without any movable control surfaces. The only movable control surface is rudder on our boat. Pitch stability of the W-foil vessel can be already compared with the pitch stability of the classical boat hull. In the case that front hydrofoils are wetted more than necessary for certain speed, they produce extra lift and erase the nose of the vessel. That was for the long waves. For short waves, the hydrofoil just cuts the short waves because of the inertia of the vessel. And with a speed of more than 40 knots, the phenomenon of supercavitation bubbles on hydrofoils starts to prevent pitch oscillating caused by the waves. And finally, yaw stability is achieved by four foils themselves. Additionally, we can stabilize the vessel with the rudder, and the rudder allows us to compensate for possible momentum produced by the sails. Power version could be equipped with vector thrust, which brings completely different dimension in yaw stability and maneuverability. I borrowed this diagram from Mr. Spear. It is one of the best and most user-friendly diagrams for such a trip. Thank you, Mr. Spear. If we analyze this diagram, we can see that the W-foil concept improves all. I mentioned just three elements. We are increasing load factor with the canard concept, the speed or local speed in our case, with the swept angle on the hydrofoils and the lift coefficient. With the canard concept as well, and that's because of the lower hydrofoil load. Here you can see one of the possible application of the W-foil concept. With the crossbeams designed as a real aircraft wing with aerodynamic control surfaces, we can easily design hydrofoil vessel and hydroplane in one body. Such a boat plane could operate in raw waters as a boat or as a hydroplane, which is capable of takeoff and landing in raw seas as well. The W-foil 18 Albatross is our prototype concept boat. It was built just as a proof of concept and shows the direction of future WFOIL boats and maybe hydroplanes development. As a base, we choose the concept of boats from Polynesia, a concept which is reliable and efficient in all weather conditions, a concept which was developed and proved through the centuries. We also know that the boats of the future have to be really energy efficient and supportive to their users. We make boats fly and we make green-oriented boats with very low CO2 footprint as well. So after extensive testing program and a lot of public presentation, we carefully analyze all feedback and completely redesign our albatross. We got technically improved and the most important, market acceptable hydrofoil water jet vessel. Its name is the WFOIL Jet and the prototype is already under construction. The WFOIL concept has never been proved as a sailing boat, but during our research period, we made a lot of testing with the radio control models, filled with all possible electronics and with all possible directions and heights of the propulsion force. We found that the WFOIL platform is suitable for sailing boats as well. As an extra proof, we put an air propulsion or aviation power pack on our Albatross to show WFOIL platform's ability to support great pitch down momentum. So now I would like to present something for your brainstorming. Here I'm just theoretically comparing the WFOIL concept sailing boat with the AC-72. Please focus on the available force which is showing into the wind. So, the WFOIL concept produces the same amount of force in a vertical direction and in direction against the wind. And that is, of course, with a beta angle of 45 degrees. But we can constantly change this beta angle, and with that, we can make constant adaptation for sailing condition. Additionally, we can take hydrofoils completely out of the water for sailing with very weak winds or in very shallow waters. At the end, I would like to say thank you to all who make America's Cup campaign so recognizable. After the final regatta, everybody knows what hydrofoiling is, and a project like ours or yours, the people see project like ours or yours with a completely different perspective. It was notable. And and a little movie.
Hydrofoiling is a fact. Teams have spent hundreds.
Okay, start it again. Do you have a speaker? Or you can just put the microphone there. No, just switch off.
Okay. Try.
Controlli tu il volume.
It's can I start?
Try.
Hydrofoiling is a fact. Teams have spent hundreds of millions of dollars to prove that.
Do you hear? Powerful.
It's a marriage of state-of-the-art technologies and materials with old school craftsmanship. We've perfected every detail to deliver a true piece of art made of carefully selected materials and cutting-edge technologies.
This movie was made for because we are searching for investor, and it's not, I just put it in this presentation. Regarding my presentation, I know it was very brief, but for additional questions, I'm here and available. I would like to say thank you to the organizers for giving me such a great opportunity to present my work. Thank you. Grazie.
Thank you very much, Thomas. I think that you introduced a lot of questions, and I imagine that during the discussion with Tom, there are several topics to discuss. I appreciate very much this. The study, the possibility to spread all the research in FOIL and solution, and the possibility to spread it in several kind of application, not only competition, but draw from there some idea and make them more usable. So I think that could be a way that you suggest.
Just an additional sentence from my side. I'm playing open game because the open world, like Google did, it's the only way to move this forward. I mean, in general, the hybrid problem in general. And that's why I'm open for all questions, the round table or whatever.
Okay, we have time at the end of the morning. Please, I invite Giorgono to give us his contribution of today. You already met Giorgono yesterday. And now we go deeper in question of stability using forcing field. No, you can leave
your arrow, or there's the pointer.
Can you?
Yesterday, I gave you a trip down memory lane, a lot of pictures, nothing too serious. Today, I'm attempting a bit more serious science. And so I put a proper shirt on with collars and long trousers instead of sandals, so you recognize the change. But I would emphasize that I'm an amateur. And the points about being an amateur are very important. First of all, we do everything by trial and error, and the errors are numerous. It doesn't matter, because I'm not a professional, I'm an amateur. I can make mistakes and no one minds. The second thing is, we look for simple solutions. They've got to be simple, and the idea of going for no moving parts, except for the steering function, was absolutely vital, and that's where we were stuck. In those days long ago, we couldn't imagine doing anything else. The third thing has got to be inexpensive. That's common sense, really. Because we're playing with pocket money, everything's got to be inexpensive, and we've made some mistakes. I'll come back to on that. The fourth thing is small is beautiful because the forces are low and the structures are easy to replace. So small is beautiful is part of my credo. But the fifth thing about being an amateur is that you can ask me tough questions, and I can say that I don't know the answers. If Tom says, excuse me, have you remembered the Reynolds number? I'll say, I don't know what a Reynolds number is. And so now we can move on, starting at the end, just with a few images. I will take them quite quickly, if we may, Andrew. Can we have the first one? The crafts I've been associated with, we've done Icarus, so we won't come back to it at all, held the world sailing speed record B class for 14 years at the speed that then seemed very fast. And of course it was my fault. Concept, the tornado was the background that made it easy. Next one. The other craft was Mayfly, which at one time I owned. I commissioned the foils, but Philip Hansford was the designer. I don't want to take credit, except we worked together from day one. And of course, all these had the same configuration, as you see, with the V foil with an unsupported tip carrying the main load and a steering foil at the back. I just show this ancient sepia print to show how easy it was to sail. Anyone would say, you just sat there and steered. It was very, very easy. You didn't even have to be a sailor. We put novices in it. Next one, please. Now, a variety of other projects, I'm sorry, so that's the catapult, an inflatable catamaran, which I designed some foils. The same configuration, it will always be the same, with that load carried on the front crossbeam, and then this rudder foil stuck out on a false transom at the back. A high aspect ratio to surface piercing foils and very nearly unstable. The only way you could do a speed run on this over 500 meters was to hold your breath. Well, you couldn't know what else to do. It was in incipient instability the entire time. Next one, please. Now, this one, looking solid and stable and perhaps traveling fast, I'm going to come back to. a biplane rig, two Torreira rigs, a biplane foil, and I'm going to go into this a bit more towards the end, because it was, in fact, had a lot of things wrong with it, which I hope you'll learn from, to say repeating my mistakes. Next slide, please. And here is what a wonderful picture from all those years ago to show how photographs can lie. Look far right. There is my poor young brother, abandoned by me because I thought I got a bigger and better toy I wanted to go, trying to cope with Icarus One on a windy day in the Weymouth Speed Week. And there, in the foreground, apparently in solid, stable, steady flight, is Icarus Two, which is totally my baby. We might come back to that in more detail, but the photograph is deceptive because the whole thing was a bit of a nightmare. I'll come back to it. And the final one, we may say, of this series, next one please, is a boat, how dare I say I had a connection with this boat, but just look how similar those foils are. You've seen those previous images, they're identical. Steeply dihedral surface piercing foil, the rudder T foil, the fences seem to be in the same positions, and we thought before I met the owner that he'd even repeated some of our mistakes. We were very flattered. I never thought I'd meet the owner, but I was cruising with my wife in France, in West France, in Brest, South Brittany, 2 years ago, and she was delayed on an airplane. This boat came in and tied up. And I couldn't believe my luck. She wasn't there, she was late. And I walked around the dock accidentally holding this book on my chest. I didn't know why I did it, but I just walked around the dock. And this guy looked up at me and he said, "What are you?" I said, What are you? "Is that you?" You see. And this lovely man, Adolf Sebo, he came leaping across this machine. He jumped on, he embraced me, he called the crew, and they all came piling and bounding towards me. And I had to hug everyone. I spent 2 hours on board. And he said, "That is my Bible. You see, you have my Bible in your hand." And so I flatter myself that even at this scale, and after all, this machine did hold the open world speed record at 51 knots only 4 years ago. And so the record of this configuration for stability is fairly good. But I want now to try and tackle a few more concepts. Next slide, please. And the whole thing is a series of conflicts and compromises with high performance. Now, this audience, I'm almost embarrassed to remind you that high performance means going for a high lift to drag ratio or a low drag angle, same thing. And what you're looking for with a hydrofoil, of course, is deep immersion. Of course, in air, you're always deeply immersed because you're surrounded by it. But a hydrofoil must be deeply immersed. And of course, if it's horizontal with no dihedral, you don't lose the cosine. You don't lose the cosine loss of a dihedral foil. And you need, of course, to go for a high aspect ratio, which I'll amplify in a moment. But our rough and ready guide was that you lost through aspect ratio, the aspect ratio over A plus 2. In other words, if the aspect ratio is 2, you halved the efficiency. And of course, if you get up to about 10, it becomes a pretty small percentage. Put in 10 for A, and 10 over 14 looks pretty good. And you have to strive for a high performance foil section if you can. And we had a Bible, I have it in my book there, in my case there, I'll produce it later. Abbott and von Dornhoff had all the performance graphs for the standard NACA sections, and there was a 45 degree line, which I'll show you later. We could get performance straight out of our Bible of long ago. The thickness to chord ratio is interesting because if it's less than 10 to 1, you don't get a section performance better than 100 to 1. And of course, the aircraft wings are all peaky lift distributions, and we opted for the opposite, which is the ogival, for reasons which I'll come back to. But I'd just like to illustrate what we can do just with pictures to show those high lift to drag features. Next slide, please. And so you only want to look at that. It's got everything. It's got a very thick wick section, it's got a huge long aspect ratio, and the whole craft of a modern glider has a lift to drag ratio of better than 100 to 1. It's drag angle. It's a flight angle. It is 1 in 100. And as you know, the history is going up from 1 in 30 to 1 in 50 to 1 in 70 to 1 in 100. And you even know that you can put an engine in it because gliders carry water ballast. And of course, as soon as you've got water ballast for racing, in good conditions, you can put an engine in the front. And I wish I owned one. I couldn't afford it. So that's one high aspect ratio. Another one, if you have another one, which is a real mega interest, my manpowered flight. That is an early flight of this beautiful machine. There's lots of books on it. I've got one at home. But you see how fast it's going by. Those bicycles are going really quite slowly. Very high aspect ratio ring. And the final one in this series is a digression. But there is the first ever successful man-powered hydrofoil, a smudgy sepia print of the main ring with high aspect ratio. And guess who's sculling it on the River Thames outside his home? It's not my claim to be the first man-powered hydrofoil. It was made in New Scientist, and I was flattered and amazed. I won't go into it. If we have another conference, I'll come and tell you about it, but not today. So now we've got to grapple with the practical constraints of, I loved to show you from our research, and it was mostly from the sculling hydrofoil, how there is a straight extract from Abbott & von Dernhoff, showing that with the NACA 4412, which is the one I use on the sculling hydrofoil, you can get a performance line of more than 100 to 1, which is the shaded area under the graph. There are vertical is the section drag coefficient, there on the bottom is the section lift coefficient. The 4 to 5 degree line joins points separated by a factor of 100, and that was useful information for us, and it seemed relevant when we went into the sailing business, but we had to abandon it for practical reasons. Next slide, please. So what are the practical constraints? Well, of course, the first massive constraint is the proximity to the air-water interface. The surface effect losses, nothing to do with ventilation or cavitation or waves or anything else, is you discount rough and ready the forced chord length underwater because of the proximity of the water surface. That's a tough thing to bear, but you can't avoid it. You, as it were, suck down the water surface and lose lift. Of course, waves, if you want to try and break records, you could stipulate that there won't be much in the way of waves, but in realistic conditions, like look out the window, there are waves when there's wind, though we don't have to go further than places like Namibia, where the current world record is held, to see people who seek calm water. But waves are a nightmare there, and the sharp front edge for all surface-piercing items, I always think of a supertanker or any modern fast boat. It cuts the water with a sharp surface, and it's got this enormous bulb underneath to reduce drag. So all items that cut the interface should have a sharp front. And that's the whole foil if you're on waves, or almost all of it, because you're bouncing up and down, you can't control it. And of course, the peaky lift section shapes are bad news because they ventilate so easily, and you need fences. So we start losing all the things that I've showed you on those previous slides. We have to have a steep dihedral. And it's very interesting that 45 degrees, we've always used, all the designs I showed you of my work, my oeuvre, were 45 degrees. And you have to have a low aspect ratio for the following reasons. Mechanical strength is self-evident. Even with modern materials, there are limitations in mechanical strength. So you've got to limit your aspect ratio a long way down. But more importantly is the topic of reserve lift intransience. And I will explain that. It's pretty obvious. If you have a low aspect ratio foil, we always taper from the tip from strut downs only, a little more immersion produces a lot more area immediately. And going back to that catapult conversion with high aspect ratio foils, it was so nearly unstable because in a transient, a momentary bow down transient, you put very little extra area back in, and therefore it was unstable. The position for the support struts is critical. It's also, in a way, very obvious. You're going to have your high-speed ride on the unsupported tip because you only want one unit to pierce the interface because of all the surface effect losses. So the design, which you know we've hung on to, and I would recommend it forever, is that you have a V-foil with an unsupported tip. That's fine. You ride on the unsupported tip, and you taper only from the strut downwards. So there are two reasons I've given you, mechanical strength and getting that extra area quickly. And the vertical tip, which we put on much later to Icarus, but I'm flattered to see it being copied by everyone else. I didn't know about hydroptery, and I forgot to ask them, but I found on the web a photograph of hydroptery upside down, and there were these beautiful vertical tips on their foils, revealed for me to see that they had one too. Now, if I could just...
I can try to change from here.
Oh, can you? Yes. Right, that's good. Okay. Now, to summarize, I like to emphasize mistakes, but we made so many, and it's so enjoyable to share one's mistakes with a lovely group like Icarus. Icarus main foils was a long series of mistakes, learning by trial and error. Going back to the first year particularly, and just taking us through rather quickly, they were too large. We had no fences, there were severe ventilation problems. We had a low dihedra, I hadn't mentioned that, but with a lot of side slip, and we had to increase it and then put on the tip. We chose, and I made beautiful foils, crafted by my own hand in wood, of these peaky lift distributions, and they were a nightmare. We did a 65310, I think, a 65410 Tom Stone, but it was a sophisticated section, and it just ventilated, and we forgot it. Of course, we had a poor choice of materials, because I was a poor, impecunious medical student and had no money, and I had to make these things out of wood, because it was a good material, and we had a great deal of trouble with the junctions and breakages. And, of course, to repeat yesterday's talk, but I just made the point that the things have got to be practical to get in out of water. They've got to be able to go afloat easily with foils retracted. Now, if I may just have a few more moments, is that all right? I'm just...
Yeah.
Are we okay?
Good. 6 minutes.
Well, I'm going to finish before time, which I want to. I'm going to take you through the Icarus... Have I got the...
You want to...
No, I just want to show you. The Icarus foils. Because we're talking about stability. Do you want to use the pointer?
Yes.
The right. To summarize this, oh, I'm sorry, I have to go run ahead.
For what?
I want to try and keep to my brief just for a few minutes, which is about stability, and make a point about the fore and aft stability, first of all. And the canard we started with these big foils, these are very accurate. I must emphasize how huge those foils were. Total area, 16 and a half square feet, to give the imperial units. And so there was an enormous reserve lift forward. And in the second year, we made them much smaller and retractable. And we kept the same configuration. And that's the canard we're all familiar with. Now, when we moved to metal hydrofoils, and this is 1968, this was 1972, with the speed sailing arrived, we could justify the expenditure, and we put the front foil a long way forward from the midpoint of the boat, where the main beam is, because we were frightened of the pitch pole, unduly frightened. It was stable, but the load was being carried quite a lot, and we had twin rudders, one hung on each transom. And I think this is called tandem or hybrid. Is that it doesn't matter what the word is, but I'd like an aircraft guy to challenge this, because I don't think this is an inherently stable concept. And I think, seriously, I think Tom would be able to very quickly tell us in the discussion. The area, by the way, was going down with experience, 16 and a half square feet total, of course, 7.5, 5.5, and then, and oh joy, what joy it was, to move the rudder foil out 3 feet from the back of the Tornado on a false transom mechanism, which I constructed myself extremely easily. We put out two Tornado boom sections and then made a rotating false transom. So this unit, this foil, tipped up behind the transoms of the boat for going afloat, and it became extremely practical and easy. And the total foil area went down to 4.7. But of course, the high flying foil area was a great deal less. Indeed, the front foil was riding on the unsupported tip, and we worried about not losing the area of the rear foil. But of course, you can't lose it. Well, I'll come back to that in my summary, that the joy of this front foil was that we only ever had the minimum required area of water. We felt handicapped by the extremely large T when you were going very fast. We could have managed with a much, much smaller T foil, but there was no way of reducing area, which is, of course, what you're stuck with when you use the inverse submerged foils. Now, if we just move on, should I do this or can I do this? I'll do it. I'm learning fast. I've learned so much about computers in this last fortnight. Now, I'm going to spend a few more moments with you, Sir Hansen, sharing with you a disaster, because this was a near miss, and this is all my own work. I was responsible for everything. This was no Tornado hulls or anything else. Icarus II was about 32 feet wide and 26 feet long. And of course, the stability, if you take a right angle off those foils, meant it was very nearly fully stabilized laterally by the foil forces meeting the center of the rigs. Because, of course, those tornado rigs are beautiful bits of kit. And, I mean, I was not responsible for them except just by being given them, actually, by the spar makers and the sail makers. But the biplane rig was extremely advantageous because it kept the center of effort down in this much larger boat. And the other thing is, it was incredibly rigid because, of course, we had an X stay to make it rigid with a high-level crossbeam, an X stay to make it rigid in that aspect. And we took lines from the top of the mast down to the back of the opposite transom, and the twist disappeared completely. So we made models first, and I could only recommend it if someone else tries this. It's an amazingly stable structure to have a biplane tornado rig with a high-level crossbeam, which was a very narrow mast section with shrouds, and then this extra stay, which went, you see, from the hounds down to the opposite transom, and that eliminated all twist. So there it was, and I'll try and go quickly through this extraordinary boat, because I tried to make it myself. I wasn't my job. I was a medic. My career is not what I did. There are my then children. I mean, they're now in their 40s. And there we are filling my garden with these huge pieces, which I engineered. They were very nearly no cost in this boat. 14 owners, nominal £100 shares, £100 GB shares, and a large amount of donated equipment. And the reason was I didn't want to risk anything in the way of money. So these hugely long crossbeams, which would look ridiculously unstable, became stable with that rig I told you about. And there is a later stage of construction. The foils were not chosen by me to be biplanes, but they were being made by Swan Hunter's shipbuilders apprentices, and they made an extrusion for Icarus, so we just had to double up the extrusion. Extrusion for Mayfly for this boat. Now, we're nearly there, and I'm glad, because I'm very lucky to have two innings. But this is another picture about how photographs can deceive. It really was a nightmare, this boat. But you wouldn't guess it, looking at that picture. It's flying high. It's an unmeasured speed. We never got down the speed track on this boat. Things went wrong. And the administration of it was a nightmare. And I don't want to be too personal, but I had a health problem. I got a stress state. I couldn't sleep at night. My skin came out in hives, and my relationship with my family, my children went wrong, temporarily, I'm happy to say. But I think it's important to realize that. And so in conclusion, I want to summarize the advantages of the surface piercing foils, and for the amateur, they are, of course, that they are simple and robust and have no moving parts except steering, and you have got to make them retractable somehow. The joy of using simple materials, they're easily constructed, easily altered, easily repaired, and they're inexpensive. But most important of all, the thought I want to leave you with as the fanatic about surface piercing foils, is the supreme advantage of only having the minimum required area in the water at any one time. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much again, James, for this contribution. If we want, we can have a little break. Unfortunately, it's not organized a coffee break, but we can have a coffee. I ask you to spend no more than 50 minutes or 20 minutes at maximum. So we start again at 11:15.
Jesus.
Okay, we are ready to start again with the final part of the session of this morning. Please, people. Okay, thank you very much. We are ready for the last session. And I introduce the speech of Thomas Junt. Okay, Scott, sorry. I have to say that I'm very happy to have Thomas here to present his work, the result of his experiences. I have to say that when we discuss of that, preparing the conference over the last month, I was very surprised because I invite him to let me have his own presentation. And he said, well, I'm quite embarrassed to be in that context.
Professional context.
Professional context. I'm a debutant in this field. And so and I tell him that every time I'm involved in teaching activity and some students of mine ask me to start and working or preparing experience, design experience in this field, I ask him if he know Mirabeau and suggest him to have a look first starting in work, because I consider that it's a very interesting project, the possibility to stress the idea to reduce weight and so leave only the structure of the boat is a very coherent way of approach a design topic. So please, Thomas, let us know something more about your experience.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you very much for listening.
I mean, that's just an example. Synthesis between foreign function, if I put it in my words, and say, what is it? Why is it closer to for my person, I'm structural imaging engineer, so during the day, I build heavy things. And in the evening, when I think about my boats, I kind of build light things. So I designed the whole thing. We didn't build it, we have a builder who built it. But I also sailed in it, so I assume what I can see. This way. So what is it? Obviously, it's a dinghy. We have three crew on the trapeze. Even though we only have two in the picture, it's basically three crew on the trapeze. It has wings. It's a monohull, very important. It's supposed to be a monohull. We want to race on the lake in the monohull, so it's a lake racer. And obviously, it has forms. It flies. To go back to the history, why? So I have to go back to the beginning, and of course, everything starts with the chains. So that's, for me, that was the dream when I was a young sailor. So somewhere in the back of my head, I always had this picture, and one day I wanted to fly, and that's thanks to James. Then there was also a team, two friends of mine, we're a team of three, we've been training together a long time, more than 20 years, I think. And it's also, to have a project, it's also a way to get the team together, so it's also a story of friendship. The three of us, we sailed basically 18-footer, We went many times to Victoria, on the other side of the lake. At the end, we only sailed it on our lake. We got to say that we came from Geneva, Lake of Geneva in Switzerland. And when you sail it on the lake, the 18 footer is quite good going, but it lacks light wind performance. So I started to modify the 18 footer, put bigger sails in it and things like that. And then about 10 years ago, this happened. This is the first tame moth, the flying moth that came to Switzerland. It's John Allen, it's a prowler. I happened to be co-owner of this boat because I wanted to learn about flying. I wanted to learn how the watt system works. Because obviously, a simple engineer in reasoning is if you can fly with 100 kilos, with foils, with jig, make the foils just four times bigger, and you can lift it 400 kilos. Easy. So that was the basic idea. Combine the two ideas. So I called Johnny Litt and asked him to work with him, and he proposed to build foils. So it took a year. So a year later, Johnny Litt sent us these T-foils, two identical T-foils, 1 meter 60 span, about 25 centimeters of board, and 0.35 square meters of section. They were quite big, and that was the first ever try to take off. It worked well from the beginning, but we were so scared. I was so scared, I was thinking, I'll let go of the sheet. Eventually, then we learned to sail the boat, and so next year, even we were so happy to sail, we still sailed in November, which never happens, it's too cold. Foiling is fantastic. Then, so that's the background. Then we had this 18-footer was flying, but of course it's not a flying boat. So we started to think, if we have a clean sheet, white sheet, what would the flying sailing boat from the lake look like? And so I started to propose specifications. Of course, it had to be a dinghy, a monohull, crew of three, because the three of us wanted to sail together. It had to be a monohull, a light racer, because the ultimate goal every year for us is, of course, to race the Boldor. Boldor is quite an easy race. You start at one end of the lake, you go to the other end, and come back, and the first one home, that's one. So there's the multi-hull section, there's the monohull section, and we definitely like to race in the monohull section. The class of the Boldor is called Helix, or was called Helix at the time. That's why the name Yahoo Helix. Yahoo designed for to race in the Helix class. Third specification, of course, it had to be a foiler, and of course as well, it had to be easy to build at the reasonable cost, like all projects. I guess. So, the white paper wasn't as clean as it wasn't as white as there are things we wanted to take over from the 18 footer, of course. Never change everything because you don't know where we are. So I decided to keep the same rig, because if you crew three people, keep the same rig, keep the same wings, same writing moment. It was well adapted to the rig, but of course it had to be much lighter. When you start foiling, there's one thing you get obsessed with is weight. Just weight. Bring the weight down. Then another thing we wanted to improve is pitch stability. Extend the distance between the centerboard and tackleboard. Obviously, the longer it is, the easier it is to get stability. Second specification, it had to be, as I said, a monohull for the Helix class. The Helix class is quite a simple class. It has to be a monohull, unsinkable, minimum crew of three, length between 5 and 14 meters. So that was the boat should fit into the same. But also, Lake of Geneva, you have to know that 80% of the time the wind is lower than 5 knots. It's a lake to do. Ski, nautical ski or whatever, but it's not a lake for sailing. So it means 80% of the time there's no flying. Because takeoff with 5 knots of wind, it's obviously not very difficult. So it, the boat also had to have a hole for lightning, which means the placement bolt. Then the foils, of course, it had to be a foiler. Here, I put this picture here in order to show what type of foils I was thinking of, what type of foiling boat it had to be. It had to get in here with nothing. So yeah, the aim was to get off with as less wind as possible, so probably big foils. And it was definitely not a speedboat, not a record-breaking boat, because in the monohull class, once you're in the air, there's way enough speed, but you have to get in the air. So it's more this type of wings that I was looking for. Than it was not a jet plane, it was a quick taker. Then it had to be easy to build at reasonable costs. That's where the space rating came in. It took me quite a long time to get to this conclusion. But if you build a light hull, it means you have, if it really has to be light, it means it's extensive design phase. It needs time and it's knowledge, which I don't have. And you have to build molds for the hole in the deck. You have a high standard of construction. It has to be watertight. There's no use to build a fantastic hull. And it's not watertight, so you spend 100,000 euros and you gain 5 kilos, and then you carry the water around. So a hull is a very costly one shot. And then in my head, I always had this idea: what if the hull shape is wrong? Because what is the ideal hull shape of a flying boat? A boat that has to glide in light wind condition. Then there's a transition mode where it starts to play. Then there's a transition mode where it starts to lift. What is the right hull form? So I didn't know. So I said, it's this, don't build a hull. It's easier. So I came up with the idea to dissociate the structure and the flotation. So that's why there's the space frame. The space frame is it's 80 meters of tube by cheap pole winder tubes. It's a couple of hours to assemble them, glue them together. But basically, it's very, very easy to build, very easy to design as well. And it's quite light. The structure here was around 40 kilos. It kind of looks, then we have the rig, the 18-foot rig, we kept the rig, we still have the same wings, and here we all still have the same billet foils. So basically, it was the 18-footer, but the new thing here that holds everything together. It quite looks like a boat because, of course, when you take the rig, you have the shrouds, the mast, the forestay. It gives you already 4 points you have to achieve. Then you have this box here that takes the whole loads from the rigging. The mast step, we have about 2 tons of compression. It's about the only load I know because we put the 2 tons of compression on with the tensioner, so we put in the load, so we know the load. And then of course it had to, we even once sailing without hull, it sails very well because it's very light. But then of course for the lake, it needs hull. So when the boat was finished from building, we ran out of time, and I haven't decided yet what kind of hull we put on. So I could buy an old hull from an M2 multi hull. So this is a multi hull. I just chopped off 2/3 of the top. I kept only the bottom, and we stick this hull to the boat, and that's how it looked like in the first year, the lake boat. So that's the reason why we have a space frame, and yes. Today I still don't know which is the right hull form, so I'm quite happy to choose this way. So technical specification: the whole thing weighs 190 kilos here at the breakdown. The sail area is 32 square meters, and we put in Genoa. See the big Genoa. And then we have 55 square meters to go down in. Or in light with condition 55 square meters to go up and when we allow for it. Foil area is 2 × 3.5 square meters. Now we have roof walls, which are quite smaller. Afterwards, I have a picture to show you. Lateral stability. Right at the moment, it's about 840 kilogram meters. It's about the same for a 20-foot two-man catamaran. The crew, 240 kilo. Every year a bit more. Which for me, right, 3.5 meters of leverage. So this gives the, I don't know how you call it, the side force, about 130 kilo side force. So I look at the ratio. I like very much the ratio to compare both side force compared to weight, about 30 kilo. I learned that from Beth Wright in his book. And, well, one more. I said we tried several hulls. The first one, as I said, is a multi-hull hull. It was a real hull. We chopped off and put a deck on it. It wasn't watertight, so we always carried water around. Then we tried a new hull. That was simply a styrofoam-shaped form with a little bit of carbon fiber removed. It was, I tried to have a flatter end at the stern, yeah, in order to give a, when it starts to fly, just get stand on the water. It's more or less like a planning surface, yeah, and it helps when you try, we usually try to work on it with dynamic. When you have enough speed, you can tilt it, and then it goes up. But with this hull, which is so small at the end, when we tilted it, it just went like a plow in the water and stopped. So this one was better for takeoff. But it was a bit small in the end, so we did a couple of dangerous dives. Didn't have enough volume in the front. Then we tried something like a laser light form. That wasn't very good at all. It had a good back, it was good planning, it had good light wind performance because we tilted it on one side. But then it was too flat here. It struck on the water with little waves. It wasn't good. So we tried the fourth one. All these three were styrofoam forms. They were very quickly made and with a little bit of carbon fiber around it. And it's quite easy to do, so absolutely no structural
load.
It doesn't take any load. If you lift it up in the end, it bends enough. That's so we tried four hulls. Then we had these original T-foils that were made in one piece. And they weren't very handy to carry around. And then, of course, we decided, well, if we change foils, we have to change the foil, but we also have to change the centerboard. We have to change the... So actually changing foils means changing four foils, rather centerboard interface. So I came up with this idea to develop a junction. I didn't come up with the idea, I got in with the MOS. Problem is, we have loads on now, but are much higher than on off. So I designed this metal piece with conical inset, so it fits in and it sticks to the other one. Obviously, it takes the loads and works. So this piece is in the rudder or in the centerboard, and with this piece, it comes apart in two pieces. We can squeeze foils. So since we have these pieces, we only have rubber and centerboard, but we have tried for 4 or 5 different foils because it's cheaper and easier to change. So these are our latest foils. As I said, we tried the high aspect ratio foils at the end here. And the funny thing is that flying condition, it's a little bit better, but not as much as we expected, but it improved our light wind performance, not flying. So must have far less drag. So we're doing better in Lightning, which was not the aim of it, but it's the of course, this one we broke 3 weeks ago in a wipeout. And the files we can see on the belt now, they're much smaller. They're about half of it because we think they were the wind, so we have a smaller set of files. And what's next? Some details. The basic control system is exactly the same as the MOF. We have the one system that works on the sender foil. And in the back we have two systems. We have this cylinder, which has a screw inside, which we turn with this this thing. So this allows to go back and forth. So the rudder foil has plus minus 3 degrees basic trim, and then of course we have the tiller extension to move the flaps. All the rudder foils have flaps on the tiller extension. Yes, of course. Then they came the wings. So we decided it would be nice to try a wing, and also because the main sheet is a lot of work. And it's my work, so I thought if we build a wing, it's much easier to sail. We started with a model, and then we built the first wing, which was quite light. The first thing it had 35 kilos, which was not bad compared to the standard rig. The standard rig is 30 kilos, so this only added 5 kilos, but it was smaller. The standard main has 24 square meters. This one had 18 square meters. It was a little bit too small. We lacked power, but it was fantastic to sail, especially sailing two people. And of course, flying with the wing is much easier than with the mainsail because the reaction of the boat is much, much quicker. It's direct. When you sheet in the mainsail, it just deforms the mast and everything, no reaction. With the wing, we sheet in, and it really, the wing helped us to sail more to windward than the classical sail. But of course, it's quite difficult to rig, and we lack power, so we build it. Next one, you can see from the color here, we extended it one meter and something, so it was longer, and we made a bigger flap. So this one was 24 square meters, but it was a lot heavier, but it also allowed to have a bigger spinnaker, and it had plenty of power. It has plenty of power to start to have it. It's good, but unfortunately, for racing and the lake, the wing doesn't help us much because the wing has a big benefit once you're in. It has like a turbo effect. With the wing, you foil faster than with the standard rig. But in light wind sailing, you sail 3, 4, 5 knots of wind speed. Doesn't make a big difference. And it makes a big difference in light wind because it's heavy, so the lateral stability is an issue. So we like to sail the wing for pleasure of sailing, but we didn't put it on for the races because in overall performance, the standard rig is easier. Conclusions after 6 years. The foiling worked, say, 80% in the first year. Then we worked 5 years, and we barely improved it. So I would say it's the limit of an amateur program. You already get a good result in a few time, but then to improve, you need data. We don't have data. We don't know. We don't have anything to measure wind strength, speed. So as an amateur, it's difficult to improve a boat, and I definitely didn't have the time to do it. So it flew well from the beginning. We tried a lot of things, and it still flies well, but hardly better. So, other conclusion after 6 years, the pros and the cons. It's like in a relationship. After a couple of years, you think a lot of cons, but you forget about the pros. I still have pros. It flies well in what we call session. plus conditions. Sesshire is our local third moon. It's our local aura. Unfortunately, it's not like the aura because, but it's the same phenomenon. The wind eats up the mountains, it comes down the lake. But we don't have cliffs, we only have hills. So the funnel effect is slightly lighter. And so we have 6, 7, 8 knots of wind. And so when the Sesshire is gone, we can fly. So we're happy with this because there's conditions that happen quite often on the lake. And it's fun. But the cons are, it's absolutely not user-friendly. The rigging time is too long. It's an 18-footer, you have to tip it over, you have to pull on the rig. It has no hull lights. It's definitely difficult to sail. It's no sailing with bells. No beer on board, no sandwiches, you lose them. And lateral stability is an issue. Under 5 knots of wind, when you don't have pressure in the sails, it's just a hassle to sail it. Balance the boat. And sailing in waves, don't try, don't go, doesn't work. Like off. There's a range of waves, you just can't sail. And capsize, of course, is a constant stress. So after 6 years, we were a bit wary of capsizing. And the whole team was a bit wary of capsizing, the time it needs to rig. So I had the answer to all this. The next boat, that's the boat that's on the parking lot. I call it Puppy Furler, so we're all getting older. again, the same thing. Well, the rendering is not the good one, but I kept the rig, I kept the rims, kept the foils, changed the hull and put on 2 old A-cut hulls on the wings. That's view from the front. So this solves, if I go back, this setup solves, we also put hull ends on and underneath the masthead we have a hydraulic jack. So you put the rig tension on, you go boom, 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 and it's on. So basically the boat can be in the water in 10 minutes. Which allows to go sailing much more. So this it's more user friendly. We can address stability is no issue. Sailing waves we don't know yet. We will try that maybe this afternoon. Definitely capsize is no stress anymore. So this is the boat that we will be sailing on the next 4 or 5 years. Hopefully, of course, you will say it's not a monohull anymore. Yeah, that was the first outing. You see, it's easy to sail. You can have beer on board, you can have friends on board, you can take people on board that have never sailed in their life. And we still can do the regattas because when we do the regattas, we take the floats off and we have the monohull. And we do it twice in a year, that's enough. Well, thank you.
I imagine that when you was a kid, you used for the bicycle the small wheel.
It's a small wheel.
Yeah,
as well, yeah.
Yes, it's
the same thing.
The same. You can take off when you learn to cycle.
Take it off. When you're tired, you can put it back on.
Thank you very much. I imagine that we can have some questions after the end of the session and. Next speech is by Chris Edwards and Philip Kentington. I don't know if only speak he for this this time, and you will be involved tomorrow. We already discussed this morning about the possibility to spread the results of application of foils and the experience they did with sea foil sea fly application is just in this field. So we're interested to go deeper in this kind of results and just understand which could be the future of this kind of application. Please, Edward.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I'd like to thank Luca Rizzotti for organising this. It's absolutely fantastic that you pulled it together. And it's been just fantastic to be part of the team here, the people we've talked about, read about. So, you know, really congratulations to Luca and his team. Fantastic. Now, yesterday there was some, I don't know whether all of you were here yesterday, but there were some pretty preeminent speakers, actually, like Martin Fisher and others. But one of the questions that was raised, I think, on at least three occasions, was whether you can take hydrofoiling offshore. And I don't think anybody really had the answer to it. There were a number of views, it's 5 years off, it's 10 years off, maybe it's not possible, you know, the boats haven't got sufficient stability. So that's quite a nice introduction, because actually this is a project that we've been working on, and it is all about offshore sailing and coastal sailing, rather than the sort of lake sailing, flat water sailing that most of the focus of hydrofoiling has been on. So that's what I'll concentrate on. The concept I'm going to describe to you is quite versatile, but what I'm going to, and there's a lot of ground I could cover. There's something like 20,000 man hours of research, development, tank testing, analysis that supports this program. But I've only got 20 minutes, so I'm going to focus on the things that are important for going offshore. The other thing that's unusual, probably, about this project is the team involved in it. We're not from the sailing community. We are all sailors. The team behind it is principally aerospace engineers. So myself and Richard Varville are the designers. Richard is technical director of a company developing space transportation systems. I'm technical director involved in defence and aerospace work in the UK of a large engineering consultancy. We've got Nigel here, who works on our instrumentation systems. But if you are going to go offshore, if you're going to develop any kind of sailing craft, you need to know about the real life, really, what it's like out there. What are the challenges? What are the requirements you need to meet? So we've got two professional sailors, Philip and Pete, with a lot of offshore experience. And that's what you need, really, because you can dream all this stuff up and put it on a CAD computer, but it's all about getting out there, proving it, and testing it in the real world conditions. So, very briefly, that's what the team consists of. To date, it's a self-funded project, so obviously that limits the kind of technology we've been able to employ in developing the prototype, which I'll talk about later on. The important thing is really where we started from and how we arrived at the concept. What we were able to do with our background was really take a completely clean sheet look at hydrofoiling. You know, we'd studied James's work, we studied all the historical work, back to Baker and the others that we heard about yesterday. And then we sat back and we said, what would we do with a completely clean sheet? So we weren't fettered with what had gone on before. We were not really interested in evolution. If it took a revolutionary concept to solve the problems, that's what we were going to do. We set ourselves particular objectives, as Martin said yesterday. It really does depend on what your objective is in terms of the type of boat and type of concept that you end up with. So very briefly, the things that we were interested in, obviously pertinent to offshore sailing. We wanted to realise the performance advantages of hydrofoils. And that we're all aware of that. We saw it last year. I mean, they are potentially huge. And we've heard all about drag and lifted drag and so on. So those advantages are there for taking. But, you know, actually achieving those in a practical craft that will go offshore is really the challenge. And we heard it yesterday. I think Martin mentioned it. He had his priorities of lift, heave stability, pitch stability. The ones that we were particularly interested in is pitch and heave. I mean, lift is fine, you can get lift. It's all well understood. The issues are heave and pitch stability. We've heard a lot today and yesterday about heave stability, so I'm really not going to cover that. I'm really going to focus on pitch stability. Interestingly, I didn't hear all that much over the last 2 days about sea keeping. And we believe hydrofoils actually give you excellent sea keeping. And if you're out at sea and you've got to press the boat hard, you know, if you're doing the transatlantic record, it's about sea keeping. It's about the ability of the crew to press the boat hard, drive through the night, not thinking, hang on, I'm on the edge here. I'm going to break the boat. I mean, you read the accounts of Bangkok and so on, it's all about nursing the boat around. You know, you've got to look after the boat, and the boat's got to look after you. It's got to be safe. You've got to be able to push it in confidence to get the high average speeds. We believe you can actually do that with hydrofoils. They actually improve your seaking if you design it properly. And that has been demonstrated in a number of defense-related programs in the 60s, particularly in the US. There was a lot of work done on the application of hydrofoils to offshore patrol craft to improve their sea keeping. It's actually been proven, it's well understood, and I think I was talking to some of the guys about William Wall and the experience there and how capable that boat was in a seaway because of the damping provided by the foils and so on. The other thing for fast passage making is obviously the comfort of the crew. If you're getting thrown around, you're going to get fatigued and so on. So this whole idea of sea keeping and stability to achieve high average speeds is what it's about for offshore sailing. And as I said, safety. You know, you've got to have a safe platform. As I mentioned earlier, as it happens, the concept we come up with is quite scalable. You could scale it down to a dinghy, you could scale it up to an ocean version. The prototype we've built is a sort of large dinghy, I would describe it as 25 foot. So those are the objectives. I said I'd concentrate on pitch stability. As I think various people have mentioned, and Tom had a good question yesterday on how the sailing industry actually assesses stability, because the aircraft industry has invested a huge amount of time and effort in understanding this and setting criteria for stability. The yachting world is not as mature as that, so those criteria don't exist, as we heard yesterday. But what we tried to do here was develop the best possible stability, particularly in pitch, to achieve our objectives. Why is pitch so important? Because it's a sailing boat. Your pitch couple, the thrust from the rig, is 10 metres up in the air. We all know the vulnerability of high-performance multi-hulls is pitching and pitch holding. Ironically, although, I mean, to me that seems very obvious, there's a lot of multi-hulls that suffer from vulnerability in terms of pitch stability. But the good designs are the ones that achieve high pitch stability. Obviously, the stability also adds to the sea-keeping safety and achieving the high average speeds. The reality of being out at sea, it's all about transient conditions. You can do all the kind of quasi-static stability modelling you like, but that's not what it's like out at sea. You are in a washing machine. The transients, the loading from the waves, the wind, the gusts, the manoeuvres, is really what you need to think about, and you need to have the stability that would accommodate that with confidence and with safety. Unfortunately, as we've seen, you know, if you don't get that right, your boat is vulnerable. And we saw it with Hydroptera, she pitch-poled at 50 knots, but fortunately nobody was killed. We saw it with Oracle, she pitch-poled. You know, if you're going to carry a big thrust in the rig, you've got to be bloody confident about the six of them. Now, T-foils at the back, the tailplane configuration, can achieve that, but not in extremis. If you do a big bear away, you get a big gust, you get a wave situation, where that T-foil approaches the surface, you're going to pitch. As it approaches the surface, you start to lose lift, and as it approaches the surface, you're gone. So we did a lot of work on the T4 configuration when we were developing this concept, but ultimately we had to reject it. It was not safe in extremis, therefore not suitable for going offshore. So how did we do it? We've heard a little bit about canards, and that is the arrangement we've gone for. I try to stay away from all the physics and the diagrams and so on, so I've just got a model of our coastal prototype, and I'll just talk through some of the basics of the concept. I'm assuming everybody's familiar with a tailplane versus canard arrangement. With a tailplane arrangement, which is the one adopted by most sailing multi-hulls, most sailing mono-hulls, MOSS and so on, is a tailplane where you're pulling down at the back and you're controlling the pitch of the boat with the tailplane, the T-foil at the back. With us, we have the canard foil right at the front, and that controls our pitch stability and controls the pitch of the boat as well. What you see at the back are just rudders which are used for displacement sailing. So let me just talk a little bit about how these work. They control the pitch of the boat, and I'll come back to that in a minute, and they give you huge reserves of pitch stability. I mean, this prototype is 25 foot long. With the foils we've got, and you can see them out in the Dingley Park. At 40 knots, this boat is designed around a 40 knot design speed. If you submerge these at 40 knots, you get 1.5 tons of upthrust, which is more than sufficient to take rig loads in any kind of transient situation. And through the testing we've done, we launched this boat in 2005. I'm still quite amazed, you know, nearly 10 years later, how this boat will handle waves. You can just drive it into a wave system, downwind, upwind. Those huge reserves of lift just give you so much confidence. And like a lot of other people have said, you know, you need a boat that's easy to sail. This boat is really easy to sail. Anybody can step on it and sail it. So the other thing I wanted to mention, and I think Phil and a couple of others alluded to this, you need these components as far apart to improve stability, and we've done that. Obviously, these need to be basically under the centre of gravity. These are as far forward as we can get them. So it's got very strong pitch stability in that sense. But the other thing is the way these read the surface, and I think we heard from Phil about getting the wand ahead of the foils, those bow foils actually read the surface of the seaway. The tailplane is reacting to the seaway that's gone past the main foils. So as we approach a wave system, the boat will pitch up, which sets more incidence on the main foils, and the back of the boat comes up. It's what's called platforming, so our boat will do that. And it will anticipate the wave that's coming in, and it will just ride straight over it. Again, exactly what you need to go offshore. You really want to just fly like that across the wave system. So this gives you quite a lot of advantages. But from an engineering and hydrodynamic point of view, it gives you some real headaches. The problem with having a foil up here is it's seeing some huge changes in incidence and dynamic effects. If you've ever gone up to the front of a bow of a multi-hull, a performance multi-hull, and sat there, you know what I'm talking about. You know, it's like this. So a conventional wetted foil would not work here. It would ventilate. So what we've done is we've gone for super ventilated bow foil technology. So these are permanently ventilated. Super ventilated is a technical term. So these are drawing air down onto the upper surface all the time. They cannot ventilate, they cannot habitate. So you know they're going to work when you need them. To achieve stable supercavitation is actually very difficult. And most of our tank testing work has been around solving that particular problem. It's an original design, and as I say, it's taken a huge investment to get there, but it was the objective we needed to reach to achieve the stability and so on. So that is the key component of the technology. First of all, getting the canard configuration and then adopting the superventilated foil technology. The main foils are conventional wetted sections, surface piercing, as James talked about, and others. Pretty well understood, no real issues to those, very standard design, you know, very well understood, and they work very well. And because they're at the centre of the gravity of the boat, they aren't seeing this very dynamic and changing environment that the bow foils are.
So,
there's some other aspects that we built into the concept which we thought were important. If we were going to go offshore, we did not want any active controls. WOMS, forward-looking radar, whatever you can think of. It's going to go wrong halfway across the Atlantic. It's going to catch you out. Maybe in time, those systems will develop and they'll come along. I mean, Boeing had the Jetfire for many years, very successful design with surface forward-looking radar. But for us on a sailing boat, that didn't seem to be the way to go. So there's no active control. The only control is the rudder. You just steer. When you're foil-borne, you actually steer with the front. These come out. So all you're doing is controlling the lateral trim and direction of the boat. We can change the incidence of these foils to preset them for certain conditions. And in fact, if we're in displacement mode, we set these to zero incidence to act as our daggerboards. One of the things I haven't mentioned, actually I have here, the reality of hydrofoiling is you can't optimize a boat across the whole wind range. And as Martin said yesterday, for C-class hull up to about 16 knots, the most efficient platform is a long, slender hull. You can't beat it. The L-on-D is significantly better than a hydrofoil. So the concept of this boat is in light winds, you attract the foils and you go into displacement mode. You can't improve on that. This boat's optimised around quite a high wind range because she's offshore and coastal, so she has quite a modest rig. So that light wind performance we achieve by going into displacement mode. We have four hydrofoils. I mean, we could have adopted a sort of three-pointer. There are issues with that. What you tend to do is have a sort of barrel roll motion, and Hydroptile obviously suffered from that in other boats. That was unacceptable, so we've gone for the four-pointer. We can fly these foils comfortably, just sail it like a normal multi-hull. Just fly her on the leeward foils, tap, off you go on the other side. Structurally, I'm not going to talk about this very much, just to point out that if you're going to design a foil, you need a very stiff structure, because if your structure's flexing, your boat's racking, you're changing the foilings. I think hopefully everybody knows that. And obviously, you can play with a conventional rig or a wing set. We've not focused any development effort into that, because frankly, they're pretty well understood. We were concentrating on getting the foil technology sorted out.
How am I doing on time?
Rather than talking about it, I thought the best thing was actually to show you the boat. I mean, we're so cynical enough, I guess, as engineers to know that you can design all the bloody stuff on paper and in the computer, but you actually just got to get out there and test it. So we decided to build a prototype. We chose 7.6 meters, as it happened, so it's a kind of open beach cap type size, three crew, it's instrumented, strain gauged, and we've done a significant amount of work on validating the predictions that we've made. Validated, we've got our own VPP, we've got our own model to the foil performance, lift and drag, and we've been able to validate all that by actually going out and testing it. And most importantly, we've been able to take her out. I mean, most of our sailing is on the south coast of England in probably meter and a half waves, which for a 25-foot cat is not bad. So, you know, we've had our problems, we've had our breakages, but it's because we're out there pushing it. We want to know that what we claim here is actually deliverable, that she is absolutely pip stable. So anyway, have a look at the video. If I can get this working. Right, here we are. It's a little bit of a compilation. So there's some flat water sailing and some sailing in a seaway, and particularly some off-wind sailing in a seaway. Actually, I don't know if this is the right video, isn't it? Excuse me one minute. I'll go back one. This is a coastal prototype. So relatively flat water, offshore wind, you know, no problem. Now, I think this is out of... No, that's lighter wind. Yeah, I think this is out at sea, bigger waves. Back in the flat water. And this is a bigger following sea. It's a traditional weakness of Not help hydroponics. So yeah, so sorry for rather cut composition, but I was trying to show all the different conditions. As I say, a lot of our sailing has been in sort of coastal waters, passage making and so on. So that's all very interesting. So we're pretty confident that you know, we've got the solution to the offshore problem. What we've done is we've laid out an ocean version. It depends what you want to do with records, blue ribbon, dual fern, would determine the size of the boat. One advantage with going hydrophores is that you can get the records with a much smaller boat and you get a much better margin on the average speed. So that's obviously key. So at the moment, the only way to beat the records is to just go bigger and bigger. And how much bigger than Bangkok do we really want to go? It's a lot of money. It's a huge load for the crew and so on. The version we've drawn is about 21 metres. She was actually adopts the rig from an Orma 60. We don't really want to be involved in designing rigs. We thought we'd use one of those. So that's where it started. It's a 60-foot hull. But to get the forward configuration in the right place and so on, she's actually ended up 21 metres overall. She's a trimaran configuration. This forward system is completely adaptable to... Well, you can put it on monohulls, you can put it on cats and tries. For an offshore boat, we think the tries is the way to go for various reasons, which I'm sure most of you are aware of. So what you'll see here is actually a trimaran a version of the concept. She is in some quite nasty waves. Again, designed to set up displacement mode and porting mode. Okay, so thank you very much. I'm stuck reasonably to the time. And very happy to take questions in the panel session. As I say, there's a lot of work we've done to come up with this, and more than happy to explore that. And obviously the boat's out in Dingley Park, and hopefully we'll get out safe. Thank
Couldn't be here for presenting something about his experience on kite boats, but he sent me an exciting video that we can show you. It's 5 minutes length, and we have here Mirko Babini, who is the president of Kitesurf International Association. He was personally involved in this project, so he can introduce to you the project and something about Montag and his work, and after that we can have a look to the to the video. You can leave.
Okay, I'm really happy to be here and to spend just 1 minute to introduce Don Montagu. He's really a friend of mine, and we know each other since the early 80s, as we were windsurfer. He did a lot of sail as a sailmaker, and he's the guy, Don Montagu, that he invented the pink sail, windsurfing sail, that most of the guys that they know the windsurfing story from used it from Robin Ash for a long time. After his career as a windsurfer sailmaker, he started to be involved on kiteboarding. So he was the first guy that invented the four-line kite, because he figured out that with two line there wasn't any control on that, and he was really looking forward to have something that could be really powerful on the air, and with the four line it could improve the performance and change the angle of the attack with the wind, and use it also not only with a small board, a surfboard, but maybe also in a boat. And this is he started to do that when he left the Nash company in Hawaii. He moved to San Francisco in Alameda, and he started working in the project, in kite boat project. And he started to use first a catamaran with the kite, and then he started to improve the speed of the catamaran, because the first thing that you can see the kite can be really fast, and the boat it can go at some speed, but the kite will pull more. So say, okay, we need to improve something, and he start looking on foil. This is why at the end he continued to develop the boat from catamaran to trimaran, and put all the foil. And you will see a system really particular, super engineered. I don't know if you can say that. And to use the kite that pulled the trimaran at an amazing speed. I think that all of you will enjoy to see the video that has been done in San Francisco Bay, and as the base where he's working is in Alameda. Thank you.
sono delle mie scie. Dove sei arrivato? Qui dove siamo partiti? Prendendo l'albero del 14.
So. Finish. I hope you enjoy the movie.
Very interesting. I think we had a lot of topic and a lot of information about we can discuss now. I invite again Giono to take place and all the speakers here for the round table in which we can discuss all we discussed this morning. Yes, please, Tom, James. Before starting, Domenico asked me if there's somebody here who will take part to the regatta in the afternoon, and at the end of the forum, please pass by the secretary in order you could have all the information organization of the event. Please, John.
Okay, buongiorno, afternoon, everybody. anybody's new today that wasn't here yesterday, my name's John Fullerton. I'm a freelance journalist here. And certainly the last 2 days, I've really gathered a lot of very interesting information. And my learning curve is like this, let alone any other seafood shakes, but my curve is like this. So we've, as Andrea says, we've come to the point in the day when we can have a discussion, ask questions. Like I said yesterday, you won't have another opportunity like this. This morning week, we have a group of experts here. You've heard some of their presentations, and you won't get another opportunity like this to have a forum like this. So please take advantage. One thing I think would make things a little bit easier, if you have a point of discussion, if it's for somebody individually, just stand up or say your name, maybe the organization where you come from, just so that we have a little bit of knowledge about you, and ask your question or to individuals, or just ask generally a point for the panel to discuss. So just as a very brief little recap, we started the day with the keynote speech from Tom with some really interesting information about hydrodynamics, and particularly the A-class catamaran and all the foil combinations and structures, etc. So this was followed by more hydro and aerodynamic solutions, innovations, and Thomas Zohn, the W-foil concept, who was out yesterday demonstrating. Hopefully today we might have a little bit more reason than some to see some more of that, but some thoroughly interesting topics I'm sure that brought up. And then James Bruno again, some more concepts from Icarus, and grandfather of foiling, I heard mentioned on press releases. And then after the coffee break, more research and prototype. Thomas Jones looking at the synthesis between form and function. Mirabone, LX, very interesting concept, that one. And then Chris Edwards on the hydrofoil sailing offshore experience, Seafly. We've just heard from Seafly. And finally, Don Montague, the experience of the kiteboards and the video. Yeah, and he's gone on the water. So that's just a little bit of a, you know, a memory for you. Please, anybody who would like to kick off the proceedings with a question. I'm sure there's many from the... Yes, go ahead.
On the top, you appear to have put a huge amount of work into developing these foils and seeing what was interesting in the start. How much further can it go?
Oh, a lot further. I've only explored a small amount of the elephant, you might say. There's a great deal to go. I had hoped to try to do a kind of a design exercise to... But I just didn't have time, unfortunately. That lifting line method that I was using, the real strength of it is, if you remember on those diagrams that showed the loading, and it also had the dotted line showing the wash in the wake, that method can allow you to specify the wash and then calculate the shape that will give you that. So you can come up with a wash that will give you minimum drag, and then calculate either the twist or the planform shape that will give you that. And so, unfortunately, there just wasn't enough time to do that.
What I was trying to get to was, I think you must have tackled every single aspect of this, the design, shape, performance, and what you could do with it. Are there going to be any great advances in these?
Oh, well, I haven't even begun to explore, you know, what you can do with these. And the other thing is, again, I was only looking at the drag due to lift. I wasn't looking at the profile drag that goes with that. And so I really don't have any idea what the end performance could be in the A-class. And they're doing things with the winglets, for example, and I haven't even started to explore the effect of the winglets on the foils.
So Tom, you were concentrating much of your presentation on the A-class, but I presume that you could apply that to any other form of Feuerlingberg and go through the same sort of exercise, but come up with some very different shapes or dynamics. Would that be correct, or would it become the same formula?
The principles we were talking about yesterday, this is just one example of how to apply those same principles to a specific design. And every design, you start with the requirements, and then you try to get the best design that still meets all of those requirements.
As we heard earlier on from Mirabond and Seafly, they all have very different sort of requirements and specifics. Anybody else to further that to discussion?
Hi, my name is
Sonny
Kornhoff from Sweden, from Journalism Institute. I arrived here today, so I missed yesterday's discussions, but I heard a couple of you spoke about forking rocks as a limit. What happens after forking rocks?
Well, we did have some, it was an interesting point. We did have a point from the floor, actually. And we had a lot of discussion yesterday about stability and what the sort of limits were. I think Martin Fisher answered that question yesterday to a certain degree, but it was a very tough one. I don't know whether any of our panel would like to sort of...
Sure. Basically what happens is the foil flies by having low pressure on the upper surface and higher pressure on the lower surface. And as you get going fast enough, then that low pressure drops to the point where the water actually boils. You probably remember science experiments in school where you put a beaker of water in a bell jar and suck out the air and the water boils at room temperature. And that's literally what's happening on these foils. And so when you start to approach 40 knots and above, it's difficult to design the foil so that you can keep the pressure below that threshold. And once you get that boiling, which we call cavitation, then the drag goes up and you lose some lift and basically bad things happen, and it makes it difficult to maintain the efficiency to allow you to sail faster, because of course the faster you sail, the more efficient you must be. And so it starts to form kind of a barrier between 40 and 50 knots, and becomes very difficult as you start to get to the higher speeds.
Can I add? Yeah. I explained in my presentation we are applying the swept design on the hydrofoils. It's the same principle like with the fighter jets or the passengers and jets as well. So if we have the cross-section which is able to sustain the approximately speed of 40 knots, it depends on the angle of attack or the hydrofoil load. And then with the swept angle, if we go very radical to 60 degrees, let's say, we all know that the cosinus of the 60 degrees is 0.5. And if we calculate this, we can see that we can reach with a normal cross-section the speed of 80 knots. But maybe some of you know the speech of the chief design of the HydroTer project. If I understood well, the HydroTer project will go not swept, normal hydrofoil design, but with a supercavitating cross-section. So the gentleman said that they will go up to 80 knots. So with our concept, we can apply supercavitation cross-section as well. That means that we can go higher, but you know, for such a testing, you need the supporter and the money. The money is the issue, but I think the things will go very, very fast in the next few years.
Do you want to add just one?
Yeah, I think, I mean, theoretically, you can run a wetted section up to over 60 knots, and that's been done on power waterfalls very successfully. The challenge with a sailing boat, because it's a very dynamic situation, is the incidence, as you're saying, is changing a lot, the loading's changing a lot. So it's trying to remain within that cavitation envelope. So theoretically possible, I would think. I don't think 40 knots is a barrier. I think it can go higher than that.
And then after that, you're looking at supercavitating sections or base ventilated sections like Paul Larson had. So it depends what you're trying to achieve. I mean, to create an all-round boat with purely supercavitating or base vented sections would be quite difficult because it would be quite dragging. But I think it's a misnomer to say 40 knots is a barrier. It's not. It just gets more difficult.
Probably also depends on whether across this panel there's some people that have been designing boats or looking at the engineering for boats to break speed records. And obviously there are boats that are built for racing in fleets, or so there's quite a section of where that limit would probably apply.
Probably. Did you want to continue a point on that?
I was just touch on where the difference lies between, like, is the sail okay? And it's, is it a question of just using supercavitation profiles to allow it to hit 65, 70 knots? I know it was in perfect conditions, flat water in the minimum, but the interesting thing about the speed it reached is that by comparison to a kite, which hits 55 knots in the minimum, in perfect canal, the right direction to wind, they've got 70 knots of wind, whereas the sailboat is same efficiency speed as the wind, and it's only riding in 25 knots of wind. And for me, that's just beyond belief. It's a real maximisation of Mother Nature multiplied with four winds.
Should I try and answer that?
Please.
It's all about, and I think James and others have mentioned this, the drag angle. So essentially a kite foil has got quite a poor drag angle, so it's got to run downwind, basically. Yeah. Therefore, you need a stronger and stronger wind to run faster and faster. Something like sail rocket, it's got a much better drag angle, and it can extract energy from the wind more efficiently. So she can do that speeding 25 knots of wind. So she's extracting the energy more efficiently. And that's obviously what a wing does. It's about the optimum way of extracting energy, kite less efficient. In terms of the hydrodynamics, I mean, Paul Larson, he ran up to about, I think, 55 knots with a wetted section in his final trials, and then he went to a base ventilated section. Talking to him, he probably could have pushed the wetted section a bit harder, a bit further, but he knew that at some point he had to change from a wetted section, so he made that change towards the end of his trials and then went for the record once he had the confidence in the boat.
Is the shape and size of Paul Larson's final foil, forgive me, published? Because I thought he was a little bit cagey, understandably. But do you know, is it in the public record?
Yes, it would be.
The exact dimensions and the shape and everything.
I think you'll find it would be. It's because it's been recorded as a record, so I think the information will
actually,
be
available. Actually, I couldn't find it.
Yeah.
What you won't find is the section shape.
I respect him, I haven't found it. You see, there is one or two details. I asked him straight head on, and he was a charming chap, but he didn't just rush to show me. He didn't get this thing out of his pocket or his case and say, this is the final.
That's the Bible.
a long way from doing that.
No, I respect him for that. I mean, we corresponded a lot when he was moving to his new section, because we're running supercavitating foils, which in some ways are similar, not exactly the same. And he considered supercavitating sections. So running into his final record, we spent a lot of time discussing the pros and cons. But yeah, I don't think I'm at liberty to say exactly what he ended up with, because he's been careful to protect that.
Fair enough.
The term for this section is base ventilated?
Yeah. You can think of three different types of hydrofoil sections. One is the subcavitating or fully wetted section, which looks like a normal airplane wing. It's teardrop shape. And then at the other extreme is the supercavitating section, which typically looks like a sharp wedge. And the idea is that the flow separates at the leading edge and forms this cavity filled with water vapor. And that cavity doesn't collapse until well behind the foil itself. In between is the base ventilated foil, which has an approximately parabolic shape to it with a flat base. And so there's the foil is basically wetted on the top and bottom, but it's dry on that back base. And the base is filled with air instead of water vapor. That's what is called base ventilated. And the thing is that air, atmospheric pressure is typically higher than the vapor pressure of water. So you have less drag by filling that cavity with air than you would by filling it with water vapor. And so it's sort of in between the two extremes. There's sort of a narrow range in there where it's beyond what you can do with a subcavitating foil, and then as you go above that range, then you really need to move to the supercavitating.
Well, one of the challenges with the base ventilated foil, because both sides of the foil are still wetted, is that it has to run within a very small range of incidences. If the incidence increases too much, it will actually separate off the leading edge and become a supercavitating foil, which is not what you want to happen in an uncontrolled way. So on a boat like sail rocket, you can operate a base ventilated foil because you're really in control of your incidence. You're running one course angle, certain set of conditions, you know, which wouldn't work for a boat that's got to go out in the ocean or in waves or whatever, because you're seeing such a big change. So the supercavitating section we use, as Tom says, there's air on the top surface and the cavity springs open from the leading edge. And the idea is to keep it in that condition all the time. And then you can just vary your incidence. And it's very, very robust, very, very stable. So as we've said a number of times, it depends what you're trying to achieve in terms of what sort of section you would choose.
And the trade-off free lunch issue is that it's higher
drag. There's always a price to pay.
Can I make one point about the birth of speed sailing? I was there on the committee and we had a discussion about whether to go one way or two ways. And all the other world records, the land speed record and the airspeed record, were always two ways and average to eliminate trivial differences. And I fought strongly for the two-way one, but an ancient English gentleman called Peter Scott said, what would happen if you went up and down the Cresta Run in both directions and averaged it? And I was very upset. But in fact, the utilization efficient thing you got excited about, the sail rocket concept, would have been able to go both ways pretty well. They'd have had a lot of hassle, but you know, they could have done that wing the other way. Whereas we were pictured a kite going straight down wind in 80 knots of wind or something, being a very unsubtle and undesirable. But it's come out okay on a one-way track, because in fact, the efficient utilization has won. I'm happy to say, sitting here, so I was wrong. But do we just sit here? Do we think we should try go two ways for a speed record?
Good question. What do we feel about that? Anybody got any views on that?
It's become trivial, has it?
No. The reason I think one way is appropriate for a sailing craft is because the maximum speed is below a beam reach. So if you really want to determine what is the maximum speed that the boat can do, irrespective of point of sail, then I think the one way is the best way to do it. If you know, if you want to find out the best speed in around a wider variety, now you're talking about perhaps doing a closed course. And in that case, then you have to go upwind as well as downwind. But that's a different kind of record than the outright speed itself. The other craft, like power craft, typically make a run in both directions in order to average out the effect of any wind.
Yeah, sure.
But of course, averaging out the effect of wind is not what you do in a sailing craft.
Very fair to say also, though, world sailing speed records do have a number of criteria. They a bit like the Guinness World Records, I guess, they have a number of criteria of records which you fall into.
The outright record is wonderfully free of constraints.
The exciting thing is
the rules we put together 45 years ago are unchanged.
I'm very
happy about that.
Yes. Anybody else got a subject on another matter or anything else they'd like to throw at the panel? To say there's limited opportunities to do this. Yeah, go for it.
According to the slide, a map of the problem. And I ask you, why use the Bichichi polygon on the back? Because if you have the surface reading by the canal, okay, you should, you could maybe use a straight foil, the back. The orientation of the foil is the same on the bottom.
It's to get adequate heat stability. The surface piercing foil is very effective with heat stability, as you've heard. But also, as James points out, and I would have been interested to put this question to Martin Fisher, actually, you've got this advantage of losing area as you speed up. It's incredibly efficient in that respect. The problem with a fully submerged T-foil or whatever is you're carrying the same area. You might reduce the incidence, but you're carrying the skin friction, and you can't get rid of it. So, but there's a trade-off in that. I mean, it probably depends what you're trying to do. I know Martin said yesterday he felt the fully submerged version was more efficient, but it depends how you define efficiency and over what speed range. So, certainly for our boat, where we're trying to sail over a wide range of conditions, being able to have a surface piercing system where you can, as you speed up, the foil area in the water reduces is a big advantage, and that helps the performance of the boat. Also, the other thing I would say is that, I mean, our main foils are running at about 1.8 degrees, and the reason for that is to stay within the cavitation bucket for that section. If you're trying to use changes of incidence or a tail flap or whatever to control your heave stability, you've probably got a bigger challenge in terms of cavitation.
Anybody else on this side of the room? Must be. Sorry, thought I saw a hand go up. anybody from over here have a question or a query or something you'd like to discuss? Let's go ahead.
I have a question from the sporting point of view. Do you think that the foiling will put more and more emphasis on the boat and less on the vehicle?
That's a very good question. I might take that myself.
Yeah.
Does anybody else?
We can also involve some other.
Yeah, of course.
I would say no, and you had a very good example of that last year. Because what you saw going into the America's Cup Regatta were two different boats, different design approaches, and without question, what made the difference was the sailors and the sailors' ability to learn how to sail the boat to the maximum of its potential.
Yeah, I think we spoke yesterday. I don't know whether you were here yesterday, but there was quite a bit of discussion about how much more the sailors will be interacting with designers and experts like we have at this table to enhance their knowledge about the tools they have and how they use them. But at the end of the day, I think Tom's dead right. It's going to be the sailors that are going to be going out there and making it happen, not to distract anything from these designers that are sitting here. But I tend to agree. I don't think that it will distract from the performance of the sailors at all,
can
in
I
my opinion.
Add something for the power boats, because we are developing power boats. The power boats will be so fast that you need some electronic support. The people who sailing and who drive power boats are the different, for the market, you have to adapt the product for the certain market. So our next prototype, which is already under construction, will have its own operational system. From the beginning, it will be based on the iOS 7, because we have two guys, official developer from the Apple. I mean, with the certificate, they are not from the Apple. All this operational system, IT operational system, will control all the elements of the boat. And we'll keep inside the limits. And that's important because with the speed of 40 knots, 50 knots, the accident can happen really, you know, at the blink of the eye. So, but you will have always the option to switch off like ESP with the car, and you can drift or live your passion. That's it. That's our approach.
Wait, John, could I add to that?
Yeah, please.
Yeah, what I'd say is if you think about the analogy with Formula One motorsport, that's what we'll do. The technology will get ahead of us, like the race technology in Formula One cars. It will get to a point where the racing becomes boring and you just bring in some rules. So sailing predominantly is a rule-based sport. You know, we all have classes that work within certain rules, and those rules are to create competitive and exciting racing and involve the sailor. So even if the technology overtakes the sailor, we will pull it back with the rules. And that is, you know, very much the case with the America's Cup. You know, it's not an open class, it's got huge constraints, it's ended up with a foil configuration you might not have thought about because of those rules, you know, and that's created exciting sailing, it's created boats that are hard to handle, So I think that there's a solution. You know, we'll box it back in, which is exactly what Formula One have done. You know, once the engines become too powerful, they change the rules on the engine. Once the tyres have too much grip, they'll change the rules on the rubber compound. You know.
I ask this question because our background is exactly Formula One.
Yeah.
My company is working on aerodynamic development for racing cars. A lot been done in the past for Formula One.
Yeah.
And what is better is that it's maybe not as good a situation as you point out. So it's very difficult for the regulation to keep the constraint and let the people play on the car.
Well, I agree. When you're investing the sort of money that Formula One is, it's very hard to keep up with the technology. There's so much development. I think yachting is much less mature than that. So I think you'll be able to constrain this with the rules for some time. You know, but I think it's a very good point. And in developing the rules, I mean, hydrofoils bring a whole new dimension to this. You know, can you imagine a situation where you have interchangeable foils, you know, for different conditions, just like interchangeable tires? You know, do you have pit stops where you come in and change your foils? Yeah, we can potentially get into a very different type of sport. And it will come down to probably cost at the end of the day.
Well, I think there are some physical reasons, though, that will keep the sport in it. Yeah. If you notice, universally, people were talking about this trade-off between performance and stability. So you can make the boats easier to sail, but then the performance drops. And so as you're trying to get the very most performance out of the boats, you need the greatest skill on the part of the sailors. And so that's just a fundamental trade-off that you have to make. And so that will always reward the skill. And we've seen that these boats are incredibly rewarding when you get it right and punishing when you get it wrong. And so rather than going for very tiny differences in performance, there are tremendous differences in performance that are available to the skilled versus the less skilled sailor. So I think from a sporting point of view, that is sort of baked into the sport from the very beginning here.
We got an answer from the question from the Moss point. We certainly aren't changing rules because it's getting away from us. We have very good racing from a very skilled person. We'll see something about that now. I'm just racing something down the leaders or less. We'll sail the same equipment, and that's what we do with it that matters. There are subtle differences in the equipment. There's differences among boats out here. You might take a closer look and see differences between the blue and white one and all the black ones. But the people, similar skill levels, perform the same with whichever boat they've got.
So now the technology is not running away and overcoming the skill differences. The skill differences still make all the difference when you're aging. And the moth's probably further advanced in flowing than anyone else because it's smaller and cheaper to develop. And it looks to have plateaued for a while, but it hasn't really. There are still a lot of changes happening.
Well, yes, with any topics?
I want to add something to this topic.
I think the Formula One, the introduction of that is interesting because my understanding is that the top drivers and test drivers contribute a lot in an iterative design loop. And where I would say the sailor will always be important independent of the racing itself is the development of the speed of the boat, which is, I think, what Tom was saying. And then you go out and race, and the better sailors see the wind further up. They start helming up into a heading puff just in time so that their angle of field doesn't change much without changing the mainsheet. Or they know right when it's time to jive before any instruments or anybody else, because this is the best neural network we have right now. And the top sailors have been doing it all their lives, and they do it really well. So I think it'll be a long time before I place a bet on a computer.
Okay, anybody else with any other topics? Still got a few minutes for that.
A question about the control of the induced drag by Williams. And he asked that you use
lifting line.
Lifting line calculation.
Right.
And one of the most problem was the driver came from the stability.
Right.
Using a little wingtip like a winglet or other method to control the user drive, can we use the stability without the user drive?
Yes. Like the Indian blind man of the legend, I've been looking at an Asian elephant, and winglets would be an African elephant. I just haven't had a chance to look at that. Obviously, it has been very successful in practice, and in all of my charts, the leeway angle went up very steeply as the foil got submergence was low, and the winglet then would, you know, that would probably go up much less steeply with the winglet, and the winglet would reduce the induced drag. So I think that there would be an improvement in the at least in the drag. Now I don't know what it would do to the stability, and I just need to run those runs. There are many things in this data that I did not expect, like the way the anhedral improved the stability. I thought, you know, like on the America's Cup boats, maybe more dihedral would work, but it was the other way around. So there may be things about the winglet that will be total surprise if I were to do that.
Okay, I think we're getting close to going out and doing some sailing.
Yes. yes, we're getting close. We are perfectly in time. And I think that we had a further interesting day. We discussed a lot of topics, fluid dynamics, stability, and so on. Tomorrow morning we will have some more topics to discuss, more related, more focused on construction, and more focused too with the role of sailors in developing the use of these technologies. So I think that will be very interesting. Unfortunately, I'm seeing that the wind is getting down. Probably we have had to change the agenda and held the forum in the afternoon and sailing this morning, but was not so easy to do that. Any rate, we can see tomorrow morning, same time, 9 o'clock, we're going to start. And now there's the program for the afternoon with the invitation on Mott and the other competition scheduled in the program. So thank you to everybody and see you tomorrow for the fall.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.